Good afternoon. Today I'm going to talk about the enhanced knowledge discovery in data mining, which is the KDDM in short, which can be used for better decision making on student academic performance in higher education institutions. My Ahliya supervisor is Professor Mansoor Al Ali, and my Brunel supervisor is Dr. Kevin. See, when you say data mining, there is a lot of work already done on student performance. There has been a lot of researches that has happened, on, which has analyzed the student performance individually, on course taking patterns individually. And there are a lot of performance factors have been identified, and they have been researched using data mining as a tool. Now, when we see the literature, there is quite a lot of stuff available on student performance, which talks about demographic variables, previous semester marks that has been scored by the students, the gender, the attendance, the graduate streams, etc., and the course-taking patterns, which is nothing but the enrollment patterns, which has been analyzed using data mining. And there's quite a lot of work that has been done on course-taking patterns, which is the enrollment management. And on time to degree, which is the number of semesters taken by the student to complete the degree, there is some literature available which talks about the importance of summer enrollment, the changes in major, the first year GPA, the continuous enrollment, and there are a lot of literature found on time to degree. But there is, even though there is a lot of emphasis given in the literature that there has to be a study that links the student performance, which is the academic performance on the CGPA, which is scored by the student, and the enrollment management, which is the way the students has to manage the way they enroll to courses. In an American institution curriculum wherein the student has the choice to choose the courses that he has to enroll in a particular semester, it becomes very critical for a student and the advisor to decide on what courses the student has to enroll to finish on time and to have a higher GPA. So this becomes a big challenging work for the HEIs currently to analyze what are the factors that could link these three domain, which is the student performance, course taking patterns, and the time to degree, and help the students to finish on time. So using data mining, there are a lot of researches done. And when the literature was analyzed, we found that even though there were a lot of emphasis given by researchers like VLRD and Zeind and Berg, there has to be some link between these CGPA and the time to degree scored by the students. There is, of course, there is a deficiency in the research area, which has used promising tools like data mining. So this data mining are said to be a promising tools to investigate course taking patterns and the time to degree, which has been quoted by researchers like VLRD. They have attempted few researches on that, and Leon and Zeidenberg. Now, when the literature for what is KDDM, what is knowledge discovery in data mining? When we see that, sorry. There are basically certain stages in knowledge discovery and data mining, which is the business understanding, which comes the first stage, wherein we have to understand the problem, what is the problem that has been addressed by the business domain. And then there is the next stage, which is the data understanding, which wherein we have to understand the data in hand, and then we have to prepare the data in the next stage, which is the data preparation, and then comes the modeling, and then evaluation of the results, and finally the deployment. The actual deployment is nothing but using that in reality in HEIs to make decisions. So if you see the decision making here, the final deployment or the application of the findings has to be the last part, which has preceding these stages that I told you now. When looked into the literature, the KDDM as such, as I explained to you, has these many stages, and each stages have multiple sub stages wherein we have to cross through each of these steps in order to finish and go to the next stage. So when the literature is analyzed on this, there were some limitations that were found in the KDDM itself, like lack of data collection step is missing, which has been analyzed and found out by certain researchers here. And there is a lack of domain knowledge, which has been found by Redpath and Srinivasan. And there is a process model wherein they say that there is a loopback, which is missing in the model. So these limitations are analyzed, and new concepts are brought in, and they are being built on the KDDMs to enhance the current KDDM models that are available. So if you see, there is insufficiency of its capacity to handle temporal data, lack of integrated process models. So these are all the literatures that are talking about the limitations of the KDDM itself. So finally, when we see there is a lack of mandatory contextual processing stage, which is missing in the KDDM, which has been highlighted by some researchers like Wirt, Skild, and Day, but it has not been addressed through the KDDM models. And there is a new concept called context. It is not a new concept. There is a lot of research done on context itself using data mining, which has to be plugged in into KDDM in order to make it more effective and efficient in decision making in HEIs. If you see the current research work that is being done on context in data mining, there is a lot of work again done on that, wherein many have changed the algorithms, many have changed the way the data is built in, many have plugged in algorithms to access, to process contextual knowledge. So there is quite a lot of work that is being done on that, but there is still a basic lack in the context being built on the KDDM model itself. Currently, the researcher has the privilege to decide on the contextual factors that they can take, and they can, if they want, they can add contextual factors, or if they do not want, they need not add. It's not a mandatory stage. So currently, the challenges that are faced by HEIs on using these analytics is, the major issue is affordability, misuse of data, and there comes the inaccurate data. So inaccurate data is a very important issue in HEIs, which stops them from utilizing these analytics in making decisions in HEIs. So when we see the limitations, the contextual processing, how when it is missing in the KDDM model, how it affects each of the stage. For instance, it doesn't affect the business understanding, but it affects the data understanding, wherein the data which has been analyzed, which has been taken into consideration, if it doesn't include the contextual factors in it, it becomes very inefficient, and the model, the final model that comes out, doesn't have, it is not a fully comprehensive model. So the evaluation again is not fully comprehensive because it doesn't include all the factors that needs to be included. And finally, the deployment, which is in the decision making, again there is a kind of a lack, and there is a kind of the actual business problem is not completely fulfilled. So from all the analysis that we saw now, the research questions that we arrive at is the how to discover the course-taking pattern of students characterized by the contextual knowledge, which is useful in making decisions. Decisions in terms of their course enrollments, in terms of their time to degree. And the second question is what are the limitations of the existing KDDM models and how they can be altered to extract the contextual to extract the course-taking patterns, which can be helpful in making the student finish on time. Because finishing on time is a major issue in American institutions, US-based curriculum institutions. They are finding it very difficult to make the students complete on time. And if you see, there is, at each stage, this contextual processing stage has to be built in, wherein first initially we need a stage to discover the contextual factors in the contextual data understanding stage. And then the data has to be understood, it has to be, the quality measures have to be understood in the contextual data understanding stage. And then finally, there needs to be after the data preparation on the contextual data again, we need to combine the contextual data along with the general data that is taken for analysis, which will finally give us a complete model like this, which would be talking about the contextual data understanding and then the general data understanding, and then contextual data preparation, the general data preparation, and combining these two both into a common data set, which has been fed into the modeling, which would give us the accurate results, which can be used in decision making. So the additional stages that are added here are the contextual data understanding stage, the contextual data preparation stage, and the merging of these two data sets for modeling. So these are the highlighted, these are the new stages that are added in the current model, which is the contextual knowledge discovery and data mining model. As you can see, these are the stages. The blue highlighted ones are the added new added stages. And they have multiple, they have sub stages among them, within them, which would be to identify the dimensions of context, then the identify the information criticality factors, these stages are built in, which would give us a finite, definite model at the end, which would help in discovering course-taking patterns to optimize the time to degree. And see, when these stages are added, this is a complete contextual knowledge discovery data mining model, which has got the impact on each and every stage because of the addition of the new stages that are built in. At every stage, this contextual processing adds value in each and every stage by bringing in more knowledge, bringing in more factors that are contextual in nature, which can help the students in particular, and we will be able to advise the students individually through a personalized learning system, learning environment. We can advise them on what courses they need to enroll based on their caliber and the course difficulties. So the methodology used here is the design science, which has, as you can see, there are a lot of models that are available in the design science methodology. Hevner, which is the final one, is the last column one, is the highly cited model, and it has been used by many researchers. And in this research, we found this was found to be an appropriate methodology because it emphasizes on the relevance, problem relevance, and the problem quality of the artifact that has been developed. And there are 7 guidelines given by Hevner et al, which is guideline 1, design as an artifact, it should fulfill the problem relevance. And then second guideline is the problem relevance itself, how relevant it is for the researchers and to the community. The design evaluation is what strategy is used in evaluating the design, and the contributions of the research has to be effective for the design science research. And then the research rigor, the rigor with which the artifact is designed. And design has to be a search process, and the communication of the research has to be essential. So these are the research guidelines which has been adopted in this research. And how this Hevner's guidelines have been applied in the research has been mentioned here. Guideline 1, as per the guideline 1, the organizational problem, which is the HEIs problem, is to apply the apply the knowledge that has been discovered through these analytics in decision making, which is a complete lacking in HEIs because of the factors that I told you earlier, and because of the lack of these contextual factors that are missing in the analysis. So each of these guidelines have been followed, which is detailedly mentioned here. And after applying these, the evaluation method comes. The evaluation of this can be done through 5 ways. One is observational, second is analytical, third is experimental, fourth is testing, and fifth is descriptive. In this research, the functional black box testing has been done on the complete functionality of the artifact has been tested and evaluated on the results. And if you see, the testing has been done in 2 ways, the KDDM and the contextual KDDM. On the KDDM, clustering techniques, classification techniques, and association rules have been applied. Same way, in the contextual KDDM model also, clustering, classification, and association rules have been applied. And then the results were evaluated at the end using the success criteria of each of these techniques for the classification, accuracy, lift, simplicity, stability, speed, has been analyzed. For clustering, the normalized cluster means, the variable important vectors, the usefulness of the clustering has been analyzed. And for the association rules, the lift, confidence, support, recall, precision, all these factors are evaluated. And it was found that the CKDDM performed better than the KDDM in association rules and classification techniques. In clustering, it performed up to the mark, but it was not it was not extremely efficient than the KDDM models. So the contribution of this research is on the design of the artifact, which is the contextual processing stage, which was not present in the KDDM model itself. And then the actual contribution is on the extraction of the course taking patterns, which would give us the course taking patterns a student should enroll on in every semester in order to finish on time with high GPA, which can help as a guidance to the advisors themselves to advise the students. Thank you.
Subhashini, for your presentation. Now we open the door for questions. Yes.
It was a difficult one to take after lunch.
I know.
Especially, I have a number of issues. The slide of the, I'm just going to wake up the people a little bit. The slide of the contribution, if you bring it back, doesn't make any sense. Design as an artifact. The most important contribution of this research is the design artifact, the CKDDM process model itself. The artifact, a method, has been designed to address an important organizational problem, namely the lack of mandatory state to process contextual factors that are important for decision making. I can read it 10 times, I won't get an idea. Can you explain to me what you mean?
As I mentioned earlier, the KDDM model itself is suffering from certain limitations, which is the processing of contextual factors, which has been highlighted by researchers. And this contextual factors have been, this processing of contextual factors has been built in into the KDDM using the CKDDM process by inbuilting a contextual data preparation stage, data understanding stage, contextual data understanding stage, and the contextual. I'll show you the model itself, so probably you can. See, this is the model. If you see here, after the business understanding stage, the general KDDM process goes through the data understanding, data preparation, then modeling, evaluation, deployment. Now that data understanding has been split into two. One is for contextual data understanding, and one for general data understanding. So we need to understand the contextual factors separately, which is contributing to the problem in hand, and then the general data understanding, which is the general data factors that we take into consideration. Then what we need to do is to split the data preparation into two, which is the contextual data preparation stage and the general data preparation stage. And then finally, it has been merged into a common data set, which is fed into modeling. This part was missing in the original KDDM process model, which has been highlighted by researchers, and they have attempted in many ways to solve this problem. This is one of the attempt to build in this contextual processing stage in the KDDM model. So this is the artifact.
So why don't you just say the existing CKDDM model has some issues in terms of providing appropriate outcomes because of some issues to do with the data integrity or the understanding of the data integrity. Therefore, you have developed a mechanism to improve the data processing,
yes,
so that the outcomes or the results are going to be better. So that can be considered as a contribution rather than the nonsense you put at the end. In the last
that
slide.
Is the that is the technical words that is used in the literature by the information system researchers. So I cannot go away from that and say something else which is
no,
not
just
been
say
there.
What you have done. What you have said there is not
Yeah,
really
that is what has been done. The design artifact is the is what I told you in a non-technical language, but that is the technical language that has been used.
Look, what do you mean technical? The design artifact is not a technical word. It's a word to express a certain phenomena. But what you're looking at, you have a decision-making process that has some parts of it that required some improvement, and you improved it. So that's a straightforward way to explain it. Yeah, so people will actually understand what you want to do. I'm not saying what you've done is not useful. What I'm saying is you were not able, you did yourself a disfavor actually by providing some jargons at the end that doesn't really link to what you actually did. That's number one. Number two, I don't think the model actually, or wouldn't be brave to claim that the model will provide better prediction of the student attainment. So by you claiming that this model can be used to advise students, I would be quite hesitant before I say something like this, because the student is actually going, is a subject to so many factors rather than just specific subjects. But you could say it provides better understanding in capturing and mining the data about the students. So that I can take, and I think that's the line you should go for, and you will probably have a better appreciation of your contribution.
I will continue to what is mentioning. Can you go to the conclusion? Last slide.
The last slide.
So again, another thing to contribution, your extraction of course taking patterns to predict time to degree. So what? Why this is a contribution? It's how it was a contribution? I didn't understand. A student which will help to advisors to provide why we don't have this in.
It is not there.
I didn't get this at
we
all.
We are in American.
And the other part, so I can explain about your research methodology. I didn't understand about your research methodology.
Okay. When you say course taking patterns, it varies from student to student. If you see in the American system of education, the student has the liberty to register to any courses that he wants, and he can finish it at any point of time, even though there is a maximum limit, which is 8 years, which has been mentioned. But unfortunately, we are not able to guide the students on their enrollment pattern itself, because it varies from students to student. The argument is that the student, whatever I advise to student X, cannot apply to student Y.
Okay, I don't understand. This is a programming issue. You can do it by
enhancing. It is not that. Because for this, we have to go through a lot of graduated data to analyze what is the accurate course taking patterns that the student has to register. It is not just the programming or this thing. The data has to be mined, which goes through around thousands of data, or it is around 45,000 records, which has to be processed to give a decision to a student that, see, for your caliber, you're supposed to register to these courses only. And if you do that, you will be able to graduate on time, which cannot be advised to another student X, even though he belongs to the same program, because it depends on the student's potential, which is a contextual factor which has to be considered.
Could I just make an observation here? Is this a solution in search of a problem? Because we have all this data for students, and we do advise them, so I'm not clear on what type of student are we talking about? New students who are joining a degree program or those who are progressing?
The students who are progressing.
So we know what their preferences are. There are millions of data points, actually, and all of our regulators, UK, US, Bahrain, anywhere in the world, will tell you that, and they will tell you
function in the system and tool board.
Absolutely, and there are automated systems that will allow you to do that. So I think our challenge here, the questions that we're hearing, are because we can't see what the exact problem is that you are solving, and if it does need a very sophisticated data mining approach to do it.
If data is in the hands of the universities, then they can be graduating everybody on time, which is not happening currently. There is a major issue there, which has been, you should notice this slide that I showed you. There is a lot of data in hand. I know this question will be asked. That is why this slide has been included. Probably you did not take a notice on this. See, if you see.
There was too much data.
Yeah, I know.
Didn't see it.
See, this is the report given by EDUCOS, and it is the latest 2012 or 2013 publication. But after that, they did not release anything.
Here's a question. Should you believe that if it's 4 years old? Because things have moved and changed since then as well.
Yeah, but with related to HEIs, the problem still remains. We are not able to afford.
Does it though? Because you've heard from two colleagues here, I'm suggesting it as well, that some of those things may have changed. And in fact, even in James's talk this morning, he highlighted some other factors that were also echoed by the ambassador too, as being emergent factors. So I'm just wondering if you're producing a solution to a problem that doesn't exist by over-engineering something that we already have data for. I mean, I'm trying to see what you're solving here. And it looks like a lot of data for us to consume, even these charts. So
yeah. But if you see from this thing, they say there is a lot of data, but HEIs are not utilizing the data. Why? Because the reasons are these: affordability on processing these data and utilizing the data, misuse of data. The third one is regulations requiring the use of data. And then the fourth, HEIs does not know how to use this data to make decisions. This is not, I'm not telling, it is from the research papers. The fifth one is inaccurate data. HEIs can't be measured. I mean, this is what people perceive. You know, this is the research analysis which has been given. Yes, to a problem, which is the complexity in understanding the course-taking patterns of students in higher education institutions, wherein the institutions are struggling to find out what are the courses that the student has to register based on their major, which varies from student to student. Whatever I take, you cannot take. Whatever I take and get a high mark, another student cannot take. It depends on the student's potential itself. See, the student potential is one of the contextual factors which I am arguing here is these factors need to be considered before we give any decision to the students. And this is the contextual processing which is missing in the KDDM itself, because just by getting some data into the data mining and giving an analysis doesn't help us, because it is not helpful in decision making. That's what this model, as I explained that time, this contextual factors which will consider the factors of the student of the courses also is being taken into the data mining process, and then the final output when you give, it has more meaning to it and it has more decision to it. If you see this model,
we can't see that, but if you could just list two or three contextual factors which universities don't track that this model does.
Yes, the student potential, which is there is a formula to measure
the formula.
The formula is from the literature again.
And what's the formula?
The formula is the courses that the grades that the student has scored in the previous courses, which is related to this particular course, as against to the total number of students who have registered that course and who have scored.
Can I just clarify? You say data mining, but it sounds to me you're just running cluster analysis of all the existing data you could do. So in a way, you throw them all into the SPSS and you say cluster them, and then we're going to identify different groups, and then you talked about how to better facilitate students of different groups. Am I correct here? Is that what you're proposing to do, or is that what you have already done? Because it sounds to me very much like cluster analysis, even though you phrase it as data mining, but I don't know what kind of cause and effect that you have identified in your mining process. So far, it sounds to me very much just classifying students into groups based on the kind of registered data that we could get. Am I correct?
It's not only clustering
right,
and classification of students, and how the association rules can be plugged in to analyze the association between the courses and the...
So you cluster them first, and then you correlate against their final performance.
Performance. And then the association rules in order to find out the association between the contextual factors and the...
So how do you then do the association between the performance against the contextual factors?
Using association rules in data mining, we can find out the association between these variables.
Okay. Yeah.
So this was done, and then the final model, which is the CKDDM model, which took into consideration the contextual factors, how it performed, and how without the contextual factors it performed, it was evaluated, and based on that the model is being analyzed.
Sorry, it's just so that we can actually sort of end the questions now. Is this about a method for structuring the data, or is it about forecasting student behavior?
Sorry, I didn't get you.
This is a wider question. Is your research about structuring the data, or is it about predicting and forecasting student behavior?
It is to structure the data to predict the student behavior.
Okay, so thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
Maybe you can continue. So, by that, we reach to the end of the session. I'd like to thank all of you and thank also the presenters for their presentation. And now we can have a break.